he'll talk about non-commutative varieties and their geometric realizations.
Thank you very much for the invitation for this conference. It's a big pleasure finally to be again in Miami. So, and it's especially a big pleasure to say happy birthday to Ron. So, Ron, happy birthday. And today I'm going to talk about non-commutative varieties. And the geometric realizations. And first, let me define what I mean when I talk about the non-commutative variety. So what is non-commutative variety for me today? So let me start with a so-called differential gradient algebra. So it means that it's a gradient algebra, E direct sum, for all i's. So it's a gradient algebra, and of course also we have a differential. That is, the square is zero, and it's Leibniz rule holds. So this is some kind of generalization of the usual notion of algebra. So if we have a differential gradient algebra, so to any such of differential gradient algebra, E, we can, with any such algebra, we can associate the derived category of modules over this differential gradient algebra. So what is it? So we have to consider, as usually, in a homological algebra, we have to consider the homotopy category of all differential gradient modules over this differential gradient algebra, and to factorize by the subcategory of acyclic differential gradient modules. So where here the mod E is actually differential gradient category of all differential gradient modules, and this is a subcategory here that consists of acyclic differential gradient modules. Acyclics means, as usually, that we don't have any kind of cohomologies. So we have a such category, triangulated category, and actually this category has a very special triangulated, very small triangulated subcategory that is called perfect objects here, and these perfect complexes, this subcategory can be described by two ways, so two different definitions there that give the same answer. So the first is just a compact objects in the big category here. So compact means that the homes from this object to any kind of direct sum commutes with this direct sum. And also it can be described as the minimal, the smallest triangulated subcategory in this big category of all modules that contains the object E as a right module over itself, and closed undertaking direct sums. So, as I said, that actually we have a when we have a differential gradient algebra, we have a differential gradient category of all modules, and this triangulated category DE, the triangulated category of derived category of all modules, actually has so-called enhancement. So this means that by definition, that is actually can be realized as a homotopy category of some differential gradient category that I say, you know, that semi-free modules. So it's a, where semi-free modules, it's a special subcategory of all modules that actually consist of the special modules like the free, like the projective resolutions for in usual homological algebra. And so this is a, both of them are differential gradient categories. And of course, the any subcategory, like subcategory of perfect objects here, it's so this enhancement, induced enhancement for this subcategory, so it can be realized as a homotopy category of some full subcategory here that I will denote by perf E. So it's a full differential gradient subcategory here. So it's a general stuff. And now I will give a definition of non-commutative scheme. So definition will be the following. So a non-commutative scheme. So actually, I will stop here and just say that every time when I talk about non-commutative variety or non-commutative scheme, I also mean that it's derived. So it's a right thing here to write that it's a derived non-commutative scheme. But I will omit every time this word derived. So, a derived non-commutative scheme is a differential gradient category of the form perf E, like here, perf E. Where E is a differential gradient algebra that is cohomologically bounded. Bounded. So this means that it has only finitely many non-trivial cohomologies as a differential gradient category. And in this case, we will say that actually the DE will be called the derived category of quasi-coherent sheaves. On this non-commutative scheme.
Okay, I overfilled or?
Yes, thank you very much. So everything goes in the base field K. K is some kind of base. And all categories are K-linear. So why such definition? So actually, the main idea here. So the main idea as in usual, I mean that in usual commutative situation. So when we have a scheme X, then we pass to the differential gradient category of perfect complexes on X. And if we consider such, if we apply such idea, I mean that if you change X by the category of perfect complexes on X, then after that we can generalize. So after that we can generalize this approach. And to obtain more or less this definition, because there are a bunch of results of that I will formulate as a one theorem. One theorem that is a Keller and Niemann, mostly here, and something else also. So let X be a quasi compact and separated for simplicity scheme. Then, if you consider the derived category of quasi-coherent shifts on X, and if you consider the category of perfect complexes on X, then actually they can be realized. So then there is a differential gradient algebra E, such that this category will be equivalent to DE, and this category will be as a subcategory of perfect complexes, equivalent to the perfect complexes of this E. And this E is cohomologically bounded. Is cohomologically bounded. So this means that for any more or less general for us scheme as a quasi-compact and actually maybe quasi-separated, but here separated scheme, then if we consider, if we apply, if we under this idea, I mean that to pass from X to this category of perfect complexes on X, then we obtain only categories that can be realized as a category of perfect complexes over some differential gradient algebra E that is cohomologically bound. So it's a reason why we can apply this theorem, actually results of this theorem, as a definition of derived non-commutative scheme. So, and okay, we can ask some question, for example, I mean that there are different approaches to non-commutative geometry, and maybe reasonable to ask how they how they related to this approach. And it seems that any kind of approaches that, at least I know, they then can be included in this approach. So I mean that this approach is generalized, all of them. So for example, if we let us consider the simplest things, like, so what is a non-commutative affine scheme? So non-commutative affine scheme is just an algebra. So of course the differential gradient algebra is a generalization of the usual algebra. So this means that the first thing, that if A is an algebra that can be considered as a affine non-commutative scheme. So of course that this algebra can be considered as differential gradient algebra. And of course we obtain that just the usual derived category of all modules over A, it's exactly as this definition in the DE, where E is exactly this algebra considered as differential gradient algebra. So there is also another approach to the, so it's a affine affine non-commutative schemes. So, of course, there is another approach that is due to many persons like Artin, Manning, and so on. So, when you would like to talk about projective non-commutative varieties, and usually they are related to the gradient algebra. So, suppose we have some kind of gradient algebra. Something like this, and what we consider, we apply the SER approach to the coherent shifts on the projective variety. This means that we consider the special abelian category that can be considered as a quasi-coherent shifts. It's abelian category on this non-commutative variety that can be defined as a approach of A. That is a quotient of the gradient modules over A by the subcategory of the torsion modules over A. So torsion means that any element is annihilated of the, some kind of some power of the augmentation ideal here. So, and after that again we can pass to the derived category. So this is abelian category. We can consider the derived category of this abelian category. And it can be shown that under reasonable condition of this algebra, like finitely generated, that it can be realized again as a derived category of some differential gradient algebra. So we have to find some kind of classical generator here. It's possible, and we can realize it in this way. So this means that this approach is also can be included in this general approach, and maybe. If you, so I mean that I don't know a lot. So there are a lot of results about this projective non-commutative variety, but maybe I will mention just only briefly one that I will maybe use in the end of my talk. I mean that it's some kind of result of Artin, Tate, Vandenberg. They classified that non-commutative deformation of projective non-commutative deformation of the usual projective plane. They are exactly used this approach. They are considered that non-commutative projective plane as a variety that related to the algebra A, that is a quotient that it can be described as a quotient of the free algebra of V, where V has a dimension 3, so from 3 variables, by the quadratic relations where I is also 3-dimensional quadratic relations here. And so if for example, I is just an exterior power of V, then we obtain the usual projective plane. But if we deform these relations, quadratic relations, we obtain the different non-commutative projective planes. And of course, all this stuff can be described in the terms of this approach. And actually, it can be shown, for example, that the category of derived category of coherent shifts on this non-commutative projective plane has a full exceptional collection as an usual projective plane. So if you consider the bounded derived category of coherent shifts on this E2, that is actually the same as the perfect complexes of this E2, then it can be described, this has a full exceptional collections O1, O2, and can be described as actually the representation of some quiver that has three vertices, three arrows here that are denoted by U, V, and W, such that dimension of U is 3, dimension of E is also 3, and dimension of double B is 6. So it can be described. And we have some kind of map from the tensor product of U tensoring V with V to the double V. That is exactly like here. So actually, so we can identify U and V, and now the double V will be the quotient of V tensoring V by I. Anyway, I just want to give one example that I will use in the end of my talk to show that actually all approaches that I know, they are, can be considered as a particular case of this general approach. So what now? So we have definition, and we are interested to understand the world of all non-commutative schemes. But let us start with something that is should be considered as a reasonable or a simple non-commutative scheme. So as in the usual algebraic geometry,
in this last example, these P2 mu's have a moduli?
Pardon?
In this last example, these P2 mu's have a moduli?
Yes. What? It's exactly the moduli of this tensor up to action of the groups. Okay. Yeah. Pardon? In this theorem, they need it because they consider it something more, they consider it not separated but quasi separated scheme. So they generalized the result of Niemann actually, that was for separated schemes. Many notes. So, it's reasonable to talk about something that is like in usual algebraic geometry. We start from simple algebraic variety, like smooth and projective algebraic variety. So, and now I show that there are, it's possible to define smoothness or regularity and properness for non-commutative algebraic variety as well. It's actually very easy. So I mean that, so we have a non-commutative scheme. So we have this is a differential graded algebra with differential. Then we can ask how to see that this non-commutative variety is proper. So actually, very easy, we say that this non-commutative variety is proper. If you consider the cohomologies of our differential graded algebra, so at first we have a finitely many, but anyway, let us consider the sum of all of them. Then the dimension over K, that base field, of this sum is finite, so is finite. So suppose that we have such differential graded algebra, then we say that our non-commutative variety is actually proper. And it's also equivalent to say, so this property is equivalent actually to say that for any two U and V from the perfect complexes of E, if we consider the sum of all cohomologies of Holmes between them, so this is a differential graded category, so the Holmes between objects are the complexes, so now we can take the all cohomologies and consider sum here, so it will be also finite dimensional for any two objects here. So we have a finite dimensional Holmes between objects, and we have a finitely many X between objects, actually. So it's very easy. And it can be shown that it's related to the usual, if you consider commutative algebraic geometry, it's related to the usual notion of the for scheme to be proper. So also we can define, we can say what is a smooth non-commutative scheme is smooth and when it's irregular. So let us start with the smooth. So we say that perf E is smooth. Then it's a definition due to Maxim Kantsevich. If E as a bimodal, is perfect. So this means that E, in other words, E is perfect as E tensor E op modulus, modulus over E tensor E op. So it's some kind of smoothness. But you know that smoothness depends on the field, base field, I mean that it can be changed. But there is also, we can define when it's irregular. So perf E is regular. If E is a strong generator for the triangulated category perf E. So I don't want to give a precise definition what is a strong generator because not a lot of time here, but I just say briefly what is it. So if you have an object, you have a notion of generator. So generator means that the smallest triangulated subcategory that contains this object and closed undertaking direct summon, it's coincide with the whole category. But sometimes, so this means that actually you can try to give some kind of procedure to generating your category. So you can start with your object, and after that you can consider all direct, small, finite direct sums, morphing between them, cone, all direct summons of these cones, add them, and again repeat this procedure. And if you can obtain your category for the finite number of steps, then it's called the strong generator. So it's exactly, and this notion is exactly allow us to define what is a regular non-commutative scheme. Because it's also directly related in the usual situation when our scheme is regular. So I don't want to give some kind of theorem about it here. I want to go further. So, and now, it's a reasonable question. So how to obtain interesting non-commutative varieties that are smooth and proper? And well, the, one of the way to obtain a lot of different non-commutative varieties is the following. It's so we can consider so-called admissible subcategories. So what I mean? So suppose we start with the usual smooth projective variety. So let X is a, let X be a smooth projective variety. And we can consider the category of perfect complexes on X. And let us consider the some full subcategory here. So full means that it's a subcategory, full means that all homes between objects here are the same like in the big category. So we have a such a full subcategory. So and the definition, so N is called admissible. If this inclusion functor, if G has a right and left adjoint, and the left adjoint functors. Adjoint functors. So this means that it has a right and left projection. So now Suppose we have a such situation. Assume that n is admissible here. Admissible. Then it can be shown that actually, of course, it's evidence that n is improper because it's a subcategory of the proper category. But also it's easy to show that it's a regular because actually, I mean that if you have some strong generator here, but you have it because it's a smooth projective variety, then you can project it to so apply a joint functor and you get some generator here. It can, its generator will be also strong because it generates this category for the final couple of steps. So it means that in this situation, n is a smooth or a regular smooth proper non-commutative scheme. So in such way, we obtain a lot of different examples of smooth and proper non-commutative schemes. And the simplest example here, but it's of course not so interesting example because it's also a commutative variety, but I mean that the simplest example of admissible subcategory, it's called exceptional objects. Exceptional object. So E is exceptional if HOM from E to itself is a field and no any other X from E to itself. So all HOMs from shifts are trivial when M not equals zero. And if we now consider this object and if we generate if we consider the subcategory that is generated by this object in curve X, then it will be admissible and it's equivalent to the derived category of the just a point. So of course it's the simplest example. So now I would like to give another definition that is actually, so my talk is called non-commutative variety and they geometric realization. So what is geometric realization? So geometric realization is just exactly the realization of the non-commutative variety in such form, in the form of admissible subcategory. So we say, so let actually not necessarily admissible, but let me give a definition. So let curve E be a non-commutative scheme. The geometric realization, a geometric realization, of it is a realization as a full subcategory, is a realization as a full subcategory in curve X, where X is smoothly projective. Projective. So this means that there is a quasi-equivalence from the category of curve E with the sum subcategory in the full subcategory in curve X. So such functor will be called the geometric realization. And if our non-commutative scheme is smooth and proper, then this any such geometric realization give us the admissible subcategory. So actually to be admissible, it's a property of this non-commutative scheme to be actually not only proper, but also smooth. So, and what kind of examples? So of course there are a lot of different examples, but let me say something that is maybe interesting. I mean that some kind of examples. So, just to go to some results about existing of such geometric realizations, I want to say that there are really interesting examples of such non-commutative smooth and proper scheme. So, the first example, let us consider, let y be a cubic. So, y be n-dimensional cubic, smooth. Then we can consider some kind of exceptional collection, structure shift O1 and so till O n minus 2. So it's easy to check that this collection will be exceptional. And after that, we can consider the complement, semi-orthogonal complement to this collection. So it's important to understand that if you have admissible category n in perf x, for example, then you have a some complement. So this is a left orthogonal, and you have so-called semi-orthogonal decomposition in the form n left orthogonal to n. And of course, because this category is admissible, this category is also admissible. So you get not only one non-commutative variety, but you have another non-commutative variety that is a complement to this n. So, and like here, so if you have an exceptional collection, of course it generated some subcategory here that is admissible. So it's also can be considered as a non-commutative, smooth and proper non-commutative variety. But also there is some kind of complement here, such that it gives us semi-orthogonal decomposition for perfect complexes of Y. And this category is a very interesting category. So if so for example, if n is equal 3k plus 1, then this non-commutative scheme n is a non-commutative Calabi-Yau variety. So for example, when k is equal 1, so when n is equal 4, you have a four-dimensional cubic. So this n is a non-commutative K3 surface. Actually, we have a 20-dimensional family of non-commutative K3 surfaces in this case. And you can repeat it, and if you consider n equals 7, for example, you obtain that n is a three-dimensional non-commutative Calabi-Yau variety that is actually cannot be deformed, actually cannot be obtained from as a deformation of commutative variety. So it's a exactly non-commutative variety. And need to mention that this category can be realized as a category of D-brains of type B. In Landau-Ginzburg model with a superpotential double V, where double V is equation of this Y. So double V, it's just a cubic equation. So we obtain Y. And we can consider such Landau-Ginzburg model on the affine space with this superpotential. And if we consider the brains of type B, it will be exactly this category N. So another example of non-commutative, for example, K3 surfaces is another example maybe interesting to mention. I think that a lot of people here know about it, but let me just say briefly that you can consider so-called Gushel-Mukai variety. Gushel-Mukai variety that is by definition intersection of Grassmann 2,5 that has a dimension 6 with a quadratic and hyperplane. So this means that this y is a four-dimensional. It's a four-dimensional. And again, you have some exceptional collection, like structure shift, two-dimensional vector bundles that is anti-canonical vector bundle from Grassmannian, O1 and E shifted by 1. It's an exceptional collection. And after that, you can consider the orthogonal complement here. And you obtain another family of non-commutative K3 surfaces. Can be shown that it's also a 20-dimensional family. Also very interesting example. And I can formulate some kind of conjecture that actually there are infinitely many, actually countably, 20-dimensional families of non-commutative K3 surfaces. It's important to mention here that they are algebraic. So everything that I talk is only related to algebraic situation. So I cannot talk about non-algebraic varieties. So everything should be algebraic. And non-commutative also algebraic. And more precisely, they are related to positively defined two-dimensional even lattices, so the form 2A, 2B, C, and C, positively defined, so it means that more than zero. So I want to say that for any such lattice positively defined, I suspect that we have a 20-dimensional family of algebraic non-commutative K3 surfaces. And if you ask me what kind of lattices related to this example and this example, I can say that in this case, it's a 2, 1, 1, 2. And in this case, it's 2, 0, 0, 2. So it's just some kind of, not actually examples, but some kind of motivations for that, why non-commutative varieties, that they're actually interesting. And another maybe motivation, it's about phantoms. So let me give another examples of non-commutative varieties. They are now called phantoms and quasi-phantoms. So what is it? Phantoms and quasi-phantoms. So this is by definition such admissible subcategories, so such proper and smooth non-commutative variety with geometric realization. So such subcategories admissible. Such that the Hochschild homologies of this guy actually trivial. So no any kind of Hochschild homologies. And for quasi-phantom, the K0 is a finite group, K0 of this category. But phantom means that K0 is a trivial. And actually such, so of course it's something unnatural, because of course in usual algebraic geometry, you cannot have a variety such that Hochschild homologies are trivial. K0 are trivial. So actually, it can be shown that there are, that in this non-commutative world, there are examples. So I don't want to mention a lot of names here, but just to say that they exist. I mean that phantoms and quasi-phantoms, they exist. And moreover, exist phantoms in the strong sense that all K theory, not only K0, but all K theory is trivial. So it's also very special things, and they appear again. How we construct them? So look, all these examples, they are, I obtained all of them as a thin orthogonal complement to exceptional collections. Here it's a this exceptional collection, here it's another kind of exceptional collection. And in this situation, it's also, so people consider it different kind of fake Delpeche surfaces. And they constructed long exceptional collection such that the complement, so if you consider perf S, and we have some kind of, we can construct some long enough exceptional collection such that orthogonal complement will be exactly the phantom. So this means that all the interesting examples actually coming are coming with geometric realizations. But on the other side, you can consider something without geometric realization, something abstract, and ask about existing of such geometric realization of non-commutative variety. So it's exactly that I am going to talk at this moment. And of course, it's natural to ask the question, about existing of geometric realization. So assume, of course, if you have one geometric realization, you can construct a lot of different geometric realizations. Some of them more natural, some of them maybe less natural, but anyway. So, but you can ask question about, is there a geometric realization for some kind of perf E where it's a smooth proper non-commutative variety? It's a natural question. Unfortunately, I don't know answer on this question. So maybe there are some non-commutative smooth and proper varieties that they cannot be realized in such geometric way. But what I can to say, so there are some results, some positive results here that I would like to present. And at first, let us consider so today I'm going to talk, so the last part of my talk, 10 minutes. So I'm going to talk about very special non-commutative variety that are actually not like K3 surface or something like this, but in some sense opposite. I mean that they are, have a full exceptional collection. So suppose that this category has a full exceptional collection. So it's some category with a full exceptional collection, and we can ask about this geometric realization. At first, I want to mention two conjectures here, so just to show what kind of categories actually these categories with a full exceptional collection. It's like rational varieties in usual algebraic geometry, but moreover, it's a special rational variety. So at first, maybe it's reasonable to mention conjecture. The first conjecture that if perf X, where X smooth and proper usual algebraic variety, has a full exceptional collection, then X is rational. Another conjecture, I hope that is true. I'm not sure, but I hope that there are no phantoms. There are no phantoms in such categories, in such perf E. What I mean that there are no admissible subcategories that are phantoms here. I mean that this conjecture looks maybe not so attractive, but actually it's very important, my point of view, this conjecture, because it's allow you to, when you construct the full exceptional connection, it's every time the pain to prove that it's a full. So you construct something that is enough, that has a right length. But to prove that it's a full, it's every time the additional work and much more difficult than everything before usually. So, but this conjecture show you that you don't have in such situation. So I mean that, not exactly in such situation, but I mean that usually people have some variety that they have some kind of exceptional collection. But they contracted another kind of exceptional collection that has the same length, but they cannot prove that it's also full. But if this conjecture is true, then you don't know that no phantoms, and this means that any kind of exceptional collection of right lengths will be also full here. So it's just a kind of motivation. But what I want to say here, so at first, it's a, so let us consider such non-commutative variety, and in this case, we can ask about geometric realization, about possibility to find a geometric realization. And I want to give a first theorem. So let perf E has a full exceptional collection. Then perf E is equivalent some admissible subcategory for some perf X, where X smooth and smooth projective variety. So this means that it has a realization, a geometric realization in this case. So moreover, the procedure is, so the proof is constructible, so you can, so there is a procedure how to construct such X, and this X is actually the tower of projective bundles. Can be realized as a tower of projective bundles. Another theorem that is in this direction, that if you consider if A is a finite dimensional algebra such that semi-simple path is separable, so it's important for fields that are not perfect. So it's nothing for perfect fields. then again, there is a smooth projective X and a fully faithful functor from perf A to perf X that is fully faithful. So this gives us a geometric realization, and if A has a finite global dimension, so this is exactly when this category is smooth, when it has a finite global dimension. Then, of course, as I mentioned, that this is an admissible subcategory. Then, but it's follows from the general result, is admissible. And what this means actually, I mean that on the level of on the level of shifts on this X, so how to construct the, what means that functor from the category of modulus over algebra is actually fully faithful. It's the same, so it's equivalent. So existing of such functor is equivalent, so that you have an object U in the category of perfect complexes on X, such that the homes from U to itself is algebra A, and all homes from U to the shifts, all shifts, is actually trivial. It's the same. So this means that it's exactly the image of algebra A as a model to the, this category. But it's also easy to prove that if you have a such object, then you have a fully faithful function from the category of perfect complexes to the category of perfect complexes here. It, and this function is fully faithful, so this is important. I'm talking about fully faithful. And of course, in this situation, it's also reasonable to ask, is it possible to realize, to find X and U such that U is a vector bundle, not a complex, but just a vector bundle? I don't know, so I'm pretty sure that it's possible, but I cannot prove it in the general situation. I mean that for general finite dimensional algebra. But for special finite dimensional algebra, that is a quiver algebra, it can be proved. So suppose that A is a quiver algebra, that is a quiver with relations, where Q is a quiver, and has a, so vertices of this quiver is just a, so we have a n vertices, and it's an ordered quiver. So this means that for any arrow, source and less than target for any arrow. So in this situation, if you consider the perfect complexes on this algebra A, it has a full exceptional collection of the projective modules that are related to the vertices. And in this, for such algebras, so it's a very special algebras, but very important because it's exactly the algebras of the strong exceptional collections. So in this situation, we also have the following theorem. That says the following. So the theorem, let A be a quiver algebra on n ordered vertices. Then there is X smooth projective and the exact functor from the finite dimensional modules over A to the coherent shifts on X, so it's a functor between abelian categories such that the following condition holds. So the derived functor from the derived category of modules over A to the derived category of coherent shifts on X, it's the same as the perfect in this case, is fully faithful. So this means that it's geometric realization. And also the simple modules SI go to the line bundles. On X. So this implies that any A module M goes to a vector bundle on X. Moreover, the dimension of M is exactly the rank of this vector bundle U of M. So this means that all modules go to the vector bundles. So this implies that any moduli space of representation of this quiver can be realized as a moduli space of some vector bundles on the actually rational variety, because the fourth property here that X is a tower of projective bundles. So unfortunately, I. Yeah, it's just a smooth projective variety. Yes, it's just a usual variety. Yes, it's a tower of projective bundles. So everything here is the following. So we have something non-commutative, and we try to realize them as a part of commutative guy, as a admissible subcategory in the commutative situation. And unfortunately, it's a really pity. I don't have a time to say that actually. Such kind of realizations give us very interesting things. Just mentioned that let us return back to the non-commutative projective space. Then it's using this contraction, you can find this very special realization of this non-commutative projective plane, such that let us consider the Hilbert 2 of the usual projective plane. So this guy can be, has a projection on the dual P2, because it's just two points, and you have a line through these two points. And this can be realized as a projectivization of the symmetric power of the tangent bundle on this dual projective plane. But this bundle has a usual commutative deformations, F mu. So it's a deformation of this bundle. And you can consider the deformation of this four-dimensional variety. So you can consider the projectivization of this F mu. So F mu and these guys, the three-dimensional vector bundles. And you have this is the commutative deformation of the Hilbert 2 of P2. And it can be shown that actually this category, it has a different kind of semi-orthogonal decomposition. It has a simple, because it's projectivization of vector bundles, it just has a simple simple semi-orthogonal decomposition. But also it has another semi-orthogonal decomposition in the form where here we have a usual P2. Another piece is a non-commutative P2. And the third piece is a dual, in some sense, non-commutative P2 that related to the dual tensor. But actually, abstract, these guys are isomorphic. So this means here what I want to say is that this non-commutative variety can be realized as a part of the usual commutative variety. And moreover, I would like to formulate the conjecture here that any non-commutative deformation of a, say, smooth projective variety X, any non-commutative deformation, X mu, can be realized as a semi-orthogonal path, of a commutative deformation. So I mean the following. So for any X and non-commutative deformation, you can find Y, smooth projective Y, of course, a bigger dimension, and the fully faithful functor from X to the perf Y, such that non-commutative deformation here, perf X mu, is actually related to the usual commutative deformation of this variety. Like here, so non-commutative deformation of the projective plane is a part of the usual commutative deformation of Hilbert 2 of P2. So thank you very much. I'll stop here.
Any questions, comments?
I don't know. You mean that the last one about that? No, I believe that actually it should be true for any finite dimensional algebra. It's just to prove it. So I hope that I will prove it during 1 year. So I hope that I will find a way to prove it, but I mean that at this moment my proof goes by induction, and so this means that it's a quiver algebra. It's, I use induction by the numbers of vertices. So here.
So in this last conjecture,
yeah,
these are anti-Jantar formations,
pardon? I don't.
Well,
what kind? No. I mean that here I consider the non-commutative deformation. It's a just what means the non-commutative deformation of a variety means that following you have a differential graded algebra and you can take for example some kind of it's infinity algebra and you deform the multiplication of these infinity algebras, you get some kind of deformation, non-commutative deformation. So, and I want to say that all such deformation can be realized as a part of the usual commutative deformation.
In particular, it would mean that you take a more algebraic deformation.
No, only algebraic. Only algebraic. Everything does work for, it's not work for non-algebraic things, because the categories for non-algebraic things, that category really bad. I mean that they are not compactly generated. That you don't have enough compact objects. So it's only algebraic stuff. It should be very careful here again with the K3 surfaces. So for example, non-commutative deformation of all K3 surfaces, it's 22-dimensional family. But nobody knows what is non-commutative general K3 surface. Anyway, we know that it should be 22-dimensional. But we algebraic deformations, as a conjecture, should be countably many, but 20 only dimensional families, so that are algebraic.
So how far beyond P2 do you want to check? Do you know it for all the oppressors?
What?
In what cases do you know this conjecture to be true, except for P2?
I don't know. No, I mean that. So how I obtained here, I just say, so it wasn't my aim actually to prove something like V. I just proved the theorem here about this theorem here. And I have a construction. I applied this construction to P2 and I just tried to understand what is it. And finally I found that it's exactly the deformation of P2, nothing more. So it wasn't my aim to show something like this. It's just some example of the main theorem. It's just what I can consider.
So, okay. Try to understand these 20-dimensional families of non-abelian trees. You say they're parameterized by these basis of trace C, C to B.
Yes.
Do you have?
I think that they are related to such lattices, not exactly. So I'm not sure that maybe it's all, not only this lattice, but also some embedding of this lattice to the bigger lattice. So I mean that I said something more careful. So it's related to such lattices. So it should be many, but.
Can you guess which families of ordinary commutative
K3s
are contained in the family for each
matrix? Yes, it's easy. Yes. I mean that if you consider K3 surface, for example, you know that it has a Neron Severi lattice, yes? Okay? And you can take that. So let us consider K3 surface with a Neron Severi that is just C. So it's just L squared. So that is even number, yeah? I mean that. So and you have to consider such lattice L squared plus U, where U is a standard. Hyperbolic lattice. So you have this three-dimensional lattice. It's just a lattice that is a topological K0. Or it's actually I mean that you have to put minus here, but anyway, so it's a topological K0. So my lattice is here. So it's two-dimensional, but it should be here. So I mean that if you have this three-dimensional lattice and you find some sub-lattice positively defined. This lattice has a 2-1, yes, signature. But it should be positively defined to 0. So if you find sub lattice here, you it's reasonable to think that this lattice, so you have a 20-dimensional family such that this 90-dimensional family inside that 20-dimensional family.
So does that recover half sets? guess for K3 that correspond to the four folds. Yes, specific degrees at which he thinks that those K3s occur in the motive of the cubic four fold.
Yeah, but I'm not sure that I completely understood the question because maybe I don't know the.
Hassan has some very non-obvious list of
yes.
K3s that should arise from the cubic four-fold.
Yeah, I think that every time you can just yes, you have something to have additional some I don't remember some plane or something like this in this cubic four-fold. Yes, some additional cycles there. And you obtain some families. Usually they are 80 dimensional, not 90 dimensional, just maybe one of them 90 dimensional. I don't remember actually. Yeah, but I mean that, yes, there should be, so you can look here and you can try to understand what kind of usual case resurfaces can be obtained here. And I think that I check two of them maybe. I don't remember, but they are there. But there is an infinite remain. More and more, I mean that polarization, bigger and bigger polarization. Yeah, but I mean that in usual algebraic geometry, we cannot realize actually the all case resurfaces. I mean that as a full like something where. So we just know that Torelli theorem, Petesky, Shapiro, Shafarevich, Petesky, Shapiro, something like this. But to find that good realization, it's also the question to find a good kind of realization of the usual case.
As it writes down explicitly an infinite collection of degrees such that are supposed to arise from this cubic four. I wonder if you are now explaining conceptually where these numbers come from.
Maybe I'm wrong, but it seems that these families are not 90 dimensional but 18 dimensional.
You are correct.
Correct? It's not 19 dimensional, it's 18. So this means that it's a bigger lattice here. So it's a four dimensional lattice. You have Neron Severi lattice here. Neron Severi lattice plus U. So if it's 18 dimensional, so this means that Neron Severi is two dimensional. So you have a four dimensional.
Okay, so let's leave the rest of questions and comments to the break. And let's thank Dima.